the late Sultan was so relatively remotely located in Trengganu. But I understand that he became a member of the Royal Photographic Society of the UK. Did he ever like collaborate? Did he participate in shows? I mean, it sounds like he was a very lonely cameraman in Trengganu when he belonged to a photography club in the UK. Was there
interview? Very good correspondence, letters written and all that. Photographic requests, every photographer who wishes, who has the ambition of becoming an associate, to submit a portfolio, submit photographs. So he submitted them and got returned. And I think Mariam was one of them, and he was even the associate, probably the first Malay at that time, photographer. But yeah, he, like I said, he was on his own, really sick. Nobody, apart from him, I'd have to talk him something, then he just did himself. And he doesn't, and he did take so many of what he shot. I think he only printed like 20% of whatever he shot. So, his exhibition shows quite a number of. And for example, the woman Mariam leaving, there were many other shots in the studios which captured those people, you know, he just did not have. Mainly he shot very modern, he's very modern, way too hit, far ahead of his, of the present of that time. So I think he wanted to show only what, he only wanted to please the salon photographers. So he showed only something that was understood from easily passed by at that time. Didn't she want to shoot a jetty all by itself in the middle of the sea? And so a boat here and nothing on the land. The Mariam portraits, that's, there's a Mariam portrait of holding a Japanese doll as well. So then there was again the Japanese, I'm not sure whether he spoke Japanese. But my girlfriend is someone that he, when he shot photographs, he didn't say what he's inside it. And he never told me anything about the war. He never said anything about the war to me. May 69. He said nothing to his consort. And the valet was with him. I interviewed him, I spoke to him recently, and he said nothing. He said something during his speech on his birthday 2 months later. But it was much himself. So he said he was enigma, very mysterious. So that's why I say it's very difficult. There are some notes in taking off somewhere else, or that every English language man, photographic manual was translated into Jawi, Malay, into Jawi script. So many, I'm still learning a few things now and then. I just discovered as well the color came. I haven't spoken about color, we should. Color came to Malaya in abundance in the early 50s. Right. So I found this set of color, medium format negatives, this shot of Trompi negative. Very rare, so, but in the negatives, then slide through, okay, actor crew, okay, then the 35mm, colors, color negatives are the ones that hold color very well, better than the rest. If you read any wrong foreign photographer's book, Adams, color, Lati, color, they will say, ever, they all shot in transparency, especially in color slides. But in Malaya, it's quite bad. It's very, very, very difficult to find a batch of slides that's easily or reasonably easy to restore. The Marang series, fortunately, Kishore 1957, held its cover. Penang raises the KL of the late 50s, early 60s. Singapore, Kishore Rock Singapore. But the ones that hold the color well are negatives. So, yes. I discovered also the color slides of Mosquito Sea Airport.
Very good.
Very difficult to restore, but not so good. That's a quote. I don't know whether any of you remember that even in the 80s when we went to process slides, we had to send to Australia. Yeah? So some of the prints that the slides that I think were actually processed in Australia. And some were actually sent to America. Color is not sure what it is. Color to total smile is not. It's not replacing black and white. It's an alternative to black and white because you normally choose color and black and white and color back same time. So he has two cameras most of the time. Later on, for convenience, they need two cameras, especially on state reasons. This exhibition shows some photographs in short on state reasons. He actually shot himself. The big banner. He was coming up and he turned into his car and he shot. So you can see it's a bit out of focus, but because he was actually walking up and this huge crowd in front of him. See what the meaning was he looked like to him at that time. And all he only shoots when the head of state is not next to him. Only when the prime minister or somebody else. In Korea, it was impossible to shoot, almost. It's something so something. So in this show, you will see the roof. Because he was bored out of his mind. And shot the rooftops of the Yongbingwan, which is this house. South Korea was a little thing at the time. So was something. But Kanto was something that was like this. A lot of contemporary photographers shoot color for a certain reason, but this was very much just coloring the black and white, just for you to compare. And the results are quite drastic. The skyline of Singapore, this exhibition, shows a beautiful deep sky. He had another one, but he shot others in black and white, and it's very dark. Some shot was in the what's so iconic about one of the shots was the KK signboard, clipboard, which says Super Rakuna. So it was in 1958, 1959.
Perhaps maybe another one final question. Yes.
Hello, Assalamu alaikum. So my question is, has Anwarum ever told you about anything about his about motivation or why he took up photography, especially street photography? And was it, because for some people, right, some photojournalists or photography, maybe they wanted to document a period or an era or something or an event. Or did he told you anything about his motives or motivation? Because it was a hard thing to do back then, right? And because so he had to shift, process his photo somewhere else. So it must have some sort of significant motivation that in his mind or his heart.
He did tell me personally but what from some talking to people who were with him at that time. You see, street photography, there's too many things. First of all, multiplicity of things they can take. Some people concentrate on buildings, some people concentrate on people, and all that kind of thing. And so that's why I think show street photography is best when you show the passata book. The poor, the wretched poor that you see. No, really poor. And when he went to Kuala Lumpur to photograph and exhibit at the Independence Street of August 1957, remember the medal I told you about at that exhibition? He concentrated on the poor, on the men on the street. He did not show the streets of KL. Everybody has shot his flags, the celebration that was happening. And he shot that. Only that. And the other time he shot the street was in 1969. And there was nobody around. Complete opposite. But he never told, because he's very, he doesn't say, he never told any neighbors to tell. He always told me one thing, not to take it up. Too much money, you see. But it took me a long time, street photography is something very, you've got to read to be, then you can understand. In fact, photography, this, if I was a psychologist, I think I would have a street painter. Because it's actually really the mind of the photographer. What you choose to choose, you choose to take. If you're sitting on the, like, you know, the amazing thing, like, he had nobody around him, apart from the security, they didn't have him. You can choose whatever way you want to choose. But he shot it over 2 days, and he slowly found his way. Knowing him, nobody knew him in his room. It would take a long time before he snaps a photograph. Minutes, 3-4 minutes, the simplest group. So can you imagine if he shot 25 pictures of the empty streets of KL, how long that would take him? And you position yourself. A simple group photograph like this still takes minutes. I know he didn't tell me. He didn't tell anyone. Not that I know. That's the mystery of all this.
But from your point of view, do you have any idea of what his motivation is?
I think he had a hard childhood. Used to go around the street. Funny thing is that he never shot the town of Kuala Terengganu. He shot the outskirts of Kuala Terengganu, the rural areas. He never shot the sea part of the Chinatown areas and all that. Like I said, he loved to shoot the average man on the street, whatever race they are, Malay, Chinese, English, Indian. He shot a Hindu priest at the caves, very close. He shot a rickshaw, central bunkers, very close to the people. And in Kalimu, he shot the fishermen and the pastor. He lost both his parents. Was an orphan at the age of 11. And the mother soon after. And he was brought up by his aunt, Kumaimuna. A photograph of her in the book I wrote. By the way, most of this is written in the book as a monograph. And he took care of her. So maybe his childhood was, and he was always in touch with this group on a day-to-day basis. And when he finally got hold of a camera, he just wanted to capture them. There's very few photographs of ceremonies. Yeah? So of course when he goes on an official visit, he would sit at this, Red Sea, and then you take some photographs. But basically, he had a choice to choose to shoot the average daily, the mundane daily life of the guy. But that's regrettable, I think.
So, like I said, if there's any more, one more last question.
But you can see it's a much British way of taking photographs. elements of Japanese. That's why I was good balance. But is she still in there?
So if there's time, we'll conclude this question and answer session. Thank you very much, and we'll be right back to present this for that beautiful sharing. Sorry.